Welcome to the symposium on cytokine absorption, where are we, sponsored by Jafron in the occasion of the 38th International Vicenza course on AKI and CRRT. I'm going to share with you a few slides about the organization of the symposium. As you can see, I'm Claudio Ronco from Vicenza, chairing the session, and we will have two very good speakers. One is Professor Fernando Sanchez Moran, who will speak about cytokine removal therapy in sepsis, and Professor Apostolos Armaganidis from Greece, who will speak about extracorporeal blood purification in critically ill septic patient. This is the agenda, and Professor Sanchez Moran is working in the intensive care unit at the Hospital General University Castellón, Spain, near Valencia. In fact, he has been a member of the Valencian Society of Critical Care Medicine and Coronary Units and the Spanish Society of Critical Care Medicine. Has also been member of the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine, and he works in the Acute Kidney Injury Working Group. Professor Apostolos Armaganidis is professor of pulmonary and intensive care medicine in the Medical School of National and Kapodistrian University of Athens in Greece, has received a medical degree at the University of Athens, and is working as a full-time intensivist. He worked in the past in Paris, but is now working at the medical school in Athens University. And during the last 10 years, has been participating in several different trials in intensive care, and has been principal investigator in some of these studies. In the discussion, we will basically try to answer some questions, including when to apply hemoperfusion therapy, sepsis, septic shock stage, what is the selection criteria of sepsis and septic shock patients for hemoperfusion therapy. Then we will try to answer the question whether there is an impact of hemoperfusion and absorption on antibiotics and other ICU drugs. I remind you that our group in Vicenza is carrying over studies since many years on this subject. And if yes, how to manage this and eventually how to modify the prescription. Finally, we will consider how to assess the outcomes of hemoperfusion therapy on sepsis patients. We have heard in previous symposia and sessions that mortality may not be the right endpoint, and randomized control trials may actually not be the right tool to gather some evidence in this area. And in fact, I think most of these subjects will be discussed. So we want to thank Jafron for sponsoring this symposium. And without any further ado, I would like to ask Fernando Sanchez Moran to share his slides and start his presentation. Fernando.
Yes, I'm going through it. Okay, thank you very much, Professor Ronco, for your kind introduction. And I would also like to thank you, the people from Jafron for organizing this webinar. My lecture is about cytokine removal therapy in sepsis. And as we all know, sepsis is a major health problem that affects people, affect millions of people each year all around the world. Despite the advances in the last two decades, each year its incidence is increasing and it remains with extremely high mortality rates. As in other situations, early identification and management in the first hours of sepsis improve outcomes, but we're still looking for something to improve our results. in the third consensus, international consensus meeting, the most important aspect of the current definition of sepsis is that they emphasize the primacy of the non-homeostatic host response to infection. So there is a potential lethality that exceeds the simple infection and needs an emergent recognition. In sepsis, conventional therapy generally begins with resuscitation measures, but the only definite therapy is adequate antibiotic and source control in surgical cases of sepsis. There's a lot of effort that has been done looking for an alternative treatment strategy and to understand the possible role of cytokine removal therapy. I think it would be useful to take a look to the pathophysiology. I will try to simplify it as much as possible, but what we know is that there are certain molecules that they are called PAMs, pattern associated molecular patterns, that they come from bacteria or virus, and they are able to initiate the host response to sepsis. Also, there are other molecules that they are called DAMs, they are damage associated molecular patterns, and that they are part of damaged tissue, that they are able also to amplify and perpetuate the response of the organism to any insult. These pumps and dumps, they bind to the receptors, to the pattern recognition receptors, and they start the response, initiating the release of these cytokines. When the response and the host response is initiated, usually it ends with the clearance of the infection, but in certain occasions this response leads to a kind of immunoparalysis. It's an injury associated immunosuppression. And this is the state where our patient is more severe and more likely to be at risk of death. What we have seen with this is that there is a balance between pro and anti-inflammatory mediators. When this balance is correct, there is an homeostasis, and the patient is very likely to the recovery and survival. But there are sometimes that at the beginning there's a very high level of pro-inflammatory mediators, and this leads to a disbalance of between pro and anti-inflammatory mediators that is followed by a immunosuppression, and we can act in this state with therapeutic measures that might lead to recovery, but in this state is where our patient is more likely to suffer that immunosuppression and paralysis. Well, I think everybody knows this explanation is the peak concentration hypothesis. That is one of the ways of explaining which will be the place of hemoperfusion and the removing of cytokines in sepsis. And as we have a very high peaks of pro and anti-inflammatory mediators, if we apply any measure that could lower these peaks, it would be more likely to recover the homeostasis, and our patient would be in better conditions to face the infection. Another theory is the cytokinetic theory. This theory proposes that cytokines, when they are removed, they will create a cytokine gradient between the bloodstream and the tissues, allowing leukocyte to go to the specific tissue and enhance the traffic of leukocyte to that place. Another effect of this therapy will be the redirection of immunocompetent cells, so they will improve the bacterial clearance. Given all this, what we have seen, the potential role of cytokine removal therapy in sepsis will be at four levels. The first one will be removing the pathogens from the blood. The second one will be removing the endotoxin or pumps or dams from blood. The third one will be removing the activated leukocytes. And there will be a fourth level, which will consist in reducing cytokine levels. There's a growing interest in this subject, and we have seen some studies about the potential benefits of this therapy in the setting of sepsis. For example, we have it's quite recent. This is a prospective randomized study of 46 patients. 25 of them received hemoperfusion once a day for three consecutive days. And what they saw, the study shows some benefit in lung injury score. Also, there was a significant reduction in the use of vasopressor and by the day seven, and they also see a benefit in the duration of mechanical ventilation, the duration of CCRLT, and the length of stay in ICU, and a mild effect in mortality. Here's another study. This is a retrospective one. It's about 11 patients with no response to conventional treatment and high doses of vasopressors and dysfunction of two or more organs and presence suspected or proven gram-negative infection. Hemoperfusion treatment was performed once a day for three consecutive days, initially for 2 hours, and then they continue with CBBH treatment. In the primary objective, which was the decrease of vasoconstrictors and inotropic drugs, they showed that the vasopressor needs decreased by 40% and the main arterial pressure values increased within the first 24 hours. The secondary objective, the effect on inflammatory biomarkers and mortality, they saw that CRP and procalcitonin values decreased after the treatment. They also saw that mortality rate of the patients treated with hemoperfusion was lower than estimated by Apache 2 score. But we're still having some challenges about cytokine removal, like which patient will benefit most of this therapy, when to start it, for how long, which biomarkers should we use to monitor the therapy. And as this is part of the discussion, I will jump through it and maybe we will talk about it in the discussion, okay? As these are part of the discussion, hemoperfusion can be performed isolated or in combination with other renal replacement therapies, as well as with other organ support, like ECMO or cardiopulmonary bypass. The anticoagulation mode, the most frequent is heparin or low molecular weight heparin. Also, is used citrate, but it can be used with any mode of anticoagulation of using the renal replacement therapies. But we have to take in account that when we use heparin, probably the dose of anticoagulation and that we need to use, it would be higher than the normal ones. And we always should adjust the anticoagulation according to the coagulation status of the patient. About the biomarker monitoring, again, I will jump to it because it's part of the discussion. And one thing that we also have to take in account is the potential side effects of hemoperfusion. As an extracorporeal therapy, we are at risk of suffering any of the related adverse events, like risk of bleeding, clotting, dropping platelets account, and catheter complications. We have to consider the potential risk of drug removal, especially with antibiotics. So it would be of interest monitoring the level of antibiotics. We also have to think about the potential loss of other molecules like albumin, amino acids, or other nutrients. We also have to think about the possible electrolyte imbalances. Just as a kind of summary, I would like to say that currently we don't have a good evidence that could support the recommendation and the effectiveness of hemoperfusion, but this doesn't mean that there's not a place for hemoperfusion in sepsis. This happens because there are lots of studies, but each one is highly individualized, and the study is conducted through the local use. So there's not a big consensus around it. We have to think about the potential adverse event associated with the use. So we need to monitor carefully this therapy. About the possible benefits of the therapy, we have seen that there is an effective reduction of excessive cytokines, and other potential and possible benefits of the therapy would be the prevention or reduction of the capillary leak syndrome, that is part of the cytokine storm that appears in septic shock. There's also a possible improvement in hemodynamics with a reduced need of vasopressors, and also a possible prevention of organ injury. And with the permission of the chairman, I would like to share a case that we recently have, and I think it's of interest because we adapted the recommendation given to the cartridges of Jafrom for the patient with COVID-19. We adapted to a patient with a bacterial septic shock, and I think it's of interest. It was a male of 79 years old with a history of the diabetes mellitus, dyslipidemia, obstructive sleep apnea, carotid stenosis, ischemic stroke, and malignant colon neoplasm. He went through a Sugar Baker cytoreductive surgery and an IPEG. The patient experimented a good clinical progress in the ICU for 48 hours, and after that, he was transferred to the surgery ward. 2 days later, began with a royal discharge through the drainage, and after cultures, pipacillin tazobactam was started empirically. 2 days later, the patient began with clinical deterioration. He appears restless with hypotension, desaturation, abdominal discomfort, and distension. In the CT scan, the abdomen revealed loops dilatation, free fluid intra-abdominal, and pneumoperitoneum. So they went under urgent surgical reintervention. When they saw a fecaloid peritonitis due to a suture dehiscence, and this was complicated with a high suspicion of bronchoaspiration during anesthetic induction. The patient remains during the intervention with hypoxemia, hemodynamic instability. They need noradrenaline in the operation room at high doses, and the lactate was increasing. They started with meropenem and linezolid, and after that, he was admitted to the ICU. At admission, he was under sedation with a SpO2 of 95% on control mechanical ventilation with a VO2 of 0.55 and PEEP of 7. He was tachycardic with a blood pressure of 97/66, noradrenaline of 1.5 micrograms per kilogram minute. He shows signs of peripheral hypoperfusion, and there was abdominal distension and scars discharge through the drainage. Here they are the lab results. We measured the interleukin 6. It was above the upper limit of the laboratory. The SOFA score at admission, it was of 11 points. And the SAPS 2, it was of 88 points, which means a predicted mortality of 82%. Under the diagnosis of fecaloid peritonitis and septic shock and multi-organ failure, we started with meropenem and in continuous perfusion, and we continue with linezolid.
Fernando, you have to come to the end because otherwise Apostolos will not have time.
Okay, so these are the parameters of the renal replacement therapy. We attach the cartridge HA380, and we started 8 hours after admission, and 16 hours later, we could stop vasopressors. Interleukin 6, this is the evolution during the whole treatment, these 3 days. The urine output, in the first 24 hours was about 500 milliliters, and the second day it improves markedly. And of note is the drop in platelets. Initially, we changed the antibiotic to tedisolid. When we receive antibiogram, we changed to ciprofloxacin. And the only way to increase platelets was after the stopping of the hemoperfusion. Here is the evolution of procalcitonin and the RCP. We hypothesized about the platelet count, but we can exclude it was a consequence of the hemoperfusion. No other major complications related with hemoperfusion were detected. On day four, the renal replacement therapy, the treatment was stopped. On day five, the patient was weaned from mechanical ventilation. The next day, we start with oral feeding, and 2 days later, he was transferred to surgery ward. And that's all. Thank you for your
attention. Thank you very much. We have to move fast to the presentation of Apostolos Armaganidis on the use of adsorption in sepsis and septic shock, extracorporeal blood purification in critically ill septic patients. Apostolos.
I would like to thank Professor Onko and the organizing committee, as well as the Saffron Company, for the opportunity to participate in this session. And since the time is pressing, I'm going immediately to my presentation. As we know from sepsis 3 definition, sepsis is a life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to infection. The result is the world-known cytokine storm effect, with an excessive and unbalanced host immune response during sepsis. However, according to the Surviving Sepsis Campaign guidelines from 2016, extracorporeal blood purification therapies could be of interest in the battle against sepsis, but further research is needed to clarify their mechanism of action, indication, and clinical benefits. During the last 4 years, we had a number of excellent papers, experimental or clinical studies, but that conclusion from the guidelines remains almost the same. I have just selected one of the several excellent reviews published recently that says exactly that despite encouraging findings obtained from K-series and experimental evaluation, current lack of clinical RCTs limits the clinical use of acceptance by clinical acceptance by clinicians. As the authors of this review concluded, ongoing trials describing immune profiles of septic patients in the ICU will probably help clinicians to better select patients who may benefit the most from blood purification and to choose the best therapy according to their immune profile. So once again, we are speaking about personalized medicine, even in this area of hemoabsorption. Since, however, the scientific knowledge behind hemoabsorption is quite convincing, and also the pathophysiological rationale is also seems to indicate the use of hemoabsorption in order to eliminate cytokines in septic patients, we start to use this technique in our ICU in Athens, in Antikon University Hospital. And I would like to share with you our preliminary results and our experience mainly in septic patients. As you can see in this table, we have started just now to use it also in patients with COVID-19, but we have a very few patients in order to discuss anything for the moment. So I will limit my presentation to the 6 patients with septic shock. You can see that these are quite severe patients since they have at least 2 and sometimes up to 5 organ failures and a mean SOFA score of 14. In these patients, we have used the absorber HA330 hemoperfusion cartridge from Saffron biomedical. And since all these patients were already under CRRT, we have added one session of hemoadsorption per day with a duration of 2 hours for 3 consecutive days. So we have observed our patients during those 3 days and until the end of the week when hemoadsorption was applied. And we calculate their SOFA score as well as changes in oxygenation, needs for vasoactive drugs, and in our lab changes in the CRP, PCT, lactate, and platelet count. We recorded the mortality at 7 and 28 days. And also, although 6 patients is a very small number to conclude about mortality, to have an idea, we have selected from patients hospitalized in our ICU during the last year, we have selected 12 similar ICU patients in order to have, let's say, an historical control to compare with our patients under hemoadsorption. So let's see our results. You can see that there was a net improvement in oxygenation in all our patients. There is only one patient here that had a decrease of this PO2-FiO2 ratio after the first session, but this was a patient that was so much improved during the first session that we were able then to switch him to spontaneous breathing. Anyway, all these EX6 patients had an increase in PO2-FiO2 ratio, which remained until the end of the week when hemoadsorption was applied. Obviously, there was this improvement in oxygenation contributed significantly to the early SOFA score decrease recorded in all our patients. We will see the results later. The second very interesting finding was the decrease in vasopressor dose used in our patients. As you can see in this slide, in all patients, there were a net decrease of the dose of vasopressor. This is the dose of levofed in this slide. And in some of them, we are able to even eliminate completely the vasopressors at the end of three days of hemoadsorption. In one of them, we were able also to withdraw adrenaline and vasopressin, and also to eliminate vasopressin in patient number 6. So a net improvement in hemodynamics. However, we must indicate that improved hemodynamic status contributed less to the early SOFA score decrease, since vasopressor dose is not taken into consideration in the SOFA score if the arterial pressure remains more or less stable. Concerning our results in the lab, you can see that the CRP decreased also progressively during the 3 days of hemoadsorption and until the end of the week. And a similar trend was observed also in procalcitonin values. There is only one patient that had an increase after the first session, but this was a patient with an MDR acinetobacter who was already in CRRT. And when we evaluate the dose of colistin that this patient was receiving, we realized that it was insufficient for this patient. So when the dose was adapted correctly, we have also a downward trend in PCT in this patient, as was the case in all the other 5 patients. Concerning lactate, it's interesting that we have observed something that is already mentioned in the literature, that is that patients with lactic acid levels higher than 3, they had a decrease in their lactate level, but when this level was lower than 2.5, the changes were not really so significant. In order, we also calculated the platelet count variation, because this decrease in platelets has been reported in the literature as the main side effect of hemoadsorption. And in fact, we had a decrease of the platelet count in all our patients. However, we didn't have any hemorrhage or other clinical adverse effect of important in our patients. And in some of them, the platelets also increased again after the hemoadsorption was terminated after the 3 days. Also, we didn't have any other technical or problem with our patients, for coagulation or anything more. So when we try to evaluate the severity of their sepsis, we observe that what I call here modified SOFA score is a SOFA score in which, however, Glasgow Coma score and kidney function were considered stable since our patients were under sedation and CRRT. So any changes in the SOFA score is mainly due to changes in the respiratory or circulatory system function. So we can see also that in these patients, we had in all of them a decrease in SOFA score for 2 points or sometimes even more. That indicates an improvement of sepsis, a decrease of sepsis severity. This group of patients had a mortality of 83%, which is more or less what is expected from the literature, since patients with a SOFA score higher than 12 had have an expected mortality around 90% or even more. As I said before, with 6 patients, we cannot have conclusions about mortality. However, we have used an historical control group with 12 patients. These patients were selected from 232 patients with a mean SOFA score of 8 plus or minus 3 admitted in our ICU last year. And from these patients, we selected 12. We had similar characteristics with our patients in the experimental group treated with emoadsorption. You can see that the mean SOFA in this group, in this historical control group, was 13.5. 14 was in the experimental group. The mean age is quite similar. And also 1/3 of these patients were surgical patients, and the 2/3 were medical cases. When we recorded mortality in these two groups, you can see that there is a difference in the 7 and 30 days. The mortality is different, but ICU mortality is rather the same in the two groups. So our final considerations are the following. Emoadsorption is relatively simple, feasible, compatible with more RCT devices in use in our department. There were no complications observed during the sessions, and no major events were attributed to the emoadsorption sessions. All cartridges were used for the expected time without any need for changes in the filter circuitry, etc. Thrombocytopenia was observed in most patients without further implications. However, its correlation with emoadsorption session needs further investigation, of course. Septic patients appear to have improved respiratory and cardiovascular performance and hemodynamic parameters amelioration after the 3 consecutive sessions of 2 hours, as we have done in our protocol, and significant sepsis severity reduction, as indicated by changes in SOFA score, were also recorded in the aforementioned group. So our hypothesis, although further research is of course required, is that hemoabsorptions may buy crucial time at early stages of septic shock, since it may decrease or delay organ failures and extend the crucial time period within which reversibility of disease is possible with the appropriate etiological therapy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Apostolos. We will have time for 2 or 3 questions. One of the questions that comes often to the attention of everyone is, how did you manage anticoagulation when you use this HA380 cartridge? So, Fernando, quick answers, please.
If we can, we prefer to perform with citrate anticoagulation, regional citrate anticoagulation. If we need to use systemic anticoagulation, we perform it with heparin.
Low molecular weight heparin or normal heparin?
Normal heparin.
Apostolos.
Yes, we also use normal heparin because we would like to have some control, especially for these patients where we don't have very much experience. They are already in CRRT, so we use heparin with conventional treatment.
Another question is, don't you think that because of the action of this cartridge in removing cytokine in excess that may actually lead to organ derangement and dysfunction, it would be important to start quite early the therapy. So what are your criteria to start this therapy, Fernando?
Our criteria is patients with two or more organ failure, need of high doses of vasopressors, of course, the diagnosis of septic shock, and unresponsiveness to the treatment. In this setting, we measure interleukin-6 and above 1,000 picograms milliliter, we consider the patient to be a candidate to receive hemoperfusion.
Apostolos.
Yes, in our group, which is a particular group because they already are in CRRT and in septic shock. So our criteria is we can try to use it as soon as possible after we have signs of the capillary leak syndrome, or we need a high dose of vasopressors to maintain arterial pressure. So as soon as we have septic shock or capillary leak syndrome signs, we try to use this technique.
In our experience, especially in the COVID patients, what we have tried to do is actually to start even earlier, to try to avoid the one or two organ dysfunctioning, to try to avoid the hemodynamic instability. So what we did, we tried to look and follow the inflammatory parameters of this patient. And when we start to see the first sign of hemodynamic instability, we try to start. Now, I would like to stress the point that both of you clearly showed that this is a safe treatment. And we published also papers on the quality and biocompatibility of the treatment with no side effects. So it is true from one side that this is a costly therapy, that is an invasive therapy, but especially in those patients who are already on CRRT, the addition of this therapy should be considered as early as possible, I think. The other thing is some people may claim that these are futile therapies, but still, I think we are in the position to see the hemodynamic beneficial effects in these patients. So sometimes I think we have to base our approach on a pathophysiological rationale rather than on evidence that it will be definitely hard to collect. But I agree with you also that mortality cannot be the right endpoint because we don't know what is going to happen days after and so on. What is the correct endpoint is exactly to do what the cartridge claims to do, which is removal of substances that have a humoral impact on hemodynamics and on cellular function at tissue level and immunological level. Well, with this, I have to thank you for joining today symposiums. I have to thank Jafron for sponsoring the present symposium. And I really wish that these extracorporeal blood purification therapies will have an expansion and the possibility to test in a larger population the efficacy and the real clinical benefit. Thank you very much to Fernando Sanchez-Moran, to Apostolos Armaganidis, and please follow our meeting and the scientific sessions of the Vicenza course.